I would like to ask you if you would just introduce yourselves.
My name is Wilbur Carr. I'm from the Springfield, Ohio class. Mm-hmm. And this is my wife, Meredith Carr. She's also from the Springfield, Ohio class. Mm-hmm. And how that we were initiated or came into the school was purely by accident. In the year 1944, my brother was invited to attend a meeting at one of the charter members' home, where he had Dr. Kinley's son was going to speak. And his son began to speak on the human body and how the human body relates to a tabernacle, which I didn't know anything about a tabernacle pattern prior to that time. And I had been a member of the Sanctified Church of God, and I was very religious at the time, and they were supposed to make me a minister in the Sanctified Church. Mm-hmm. Well, soon after, I started going to college at Wittenberg College in Springfield, Ohio. And I had known the Bible quite a bit. And when I took the Bible course, Dr. Mueller wanted, who was in charge of the Bible school, he wanted to make me a Lutheran minister. So I said, okay, if you will come to my house and prove my brother wrong, that I'll go to the seminary and I will become a Lutheran minister. But you must prove my brother wrong in the particular doctrine that he's in. He said, it's not a religion, it's a doctrine. And so then he promised to come that night. And when he came that night, my brother got him so twisted up in what he was trying to get me to see and to become a Lutheran minister, that he jumped up. Now this Lutheran minister jumped up, who was head of the seminary at Wittenberg University, and he said, I don't give a damn if you ever come back to school again. So that made me take note. And then I had just gotten married I've been married about a year, and I had gone to church one Sunday, and the preacher began to speak about he who looks upon a woman to lust after her, in his heart he's already committed adultery, whether he has performed the act or not. So then I was condemned. So I go to the altar to confess. And my minister was a blind minister. So he asked his wife, who was also a preacher, she was sitting in the pulpit, said, who is that? And she said, that's Junie Carr. And said, is he back here again? So, because I had confessed, maybe I repented about five or six times, you know, because I've tried to, you know, live what the life they called sanctified life, which I could not go over those carnal ordinances or those Ten Commandments. And so I was a little discouraged. That evening I went home and I was crying. And my brother, who was staying with my mother at the time, and I was renting a room upstairs and he was renting another room. He came past the door, knocked on the door, and he said, I would like for you to go to class on Wednesday night, if you would, says Dr. Kinley will be here in Springfield. And I said, I'd like for you to hear Dr. Kinley. So I said, okay, I've tried everything else. I'll listen to him, I'll go. And so the very thing that was on my mind, Dr. Kinley brought out on the floor as though he read my mind and knew what was on my mind. And he told me, he said, yes, he said, but you've got to remember, at the time he used the name Christ. He said, Christ is the constrainer or restrainer. He will restrain you from that which you would do if he be in you. so that gave me comfort and cheer. And so what I was actually going to do, I was going to show Dr. Kenley how smart I was in the Bible, and he made me feel lower than an ant because of the knowledge he had and the understanding with it. Then it caused me to actually start coming to class. And I've seen some of the miracles that Dr. Kenley performed, like that I never will forget.
Call us back and
that
we'll get with you.
They had made me a treasure of this organization, of the doctor here in Springfield, of the school. And we had a business meeting one night, and there was a fellow from Cincinnati that wanted to borrow $600. When Dr. Carl Gross, who was the president at that time, and I was the treasurer, we both voted against giving him the money. The other four members voted to give him the money. And Dr. Kenley spoke up and says, I want you to lend him the money. And he says, did you hear me? I want you to lend him the money. Well, another vote was taken, and Dr. Gross, he voted for giving the money to him, but I still voted against lending the $600 because we didn't have all that money in the treasury anyway. So Dr. Kenley, he just said, I'll tell you what's happened. The Lord has given me an unction tonight that I could read anyone's mind in here. If you don't believe it, hold up your hand. I don't know. Because I was angry anyway, because, you know, I didn't want him to have the money, because I knew he wouldn't pay it back. So, to make a long story short, Dr. Kenley read my mind. He told me to concentrate and think, and he read the very three things that was on my mind. And I'll tell you the last one. I won't tell you the first two. He said, you are a very jealous individual, and there's two people here in this room tonight that you're very jealous of. I said, that's it, Doc. You got it. I believe you. Yeah, I believe you. So from then on, I began to come to class, and I would come regular that time, and he asked me to speak quite a bit on the floor, you know, because beginners, he wanted us to know what we thought we knew, and we would get up naturally and try to show off what we knew, what we thought we knew. And it took a long time for us to actually see some things. Now, another thing that I would like to bring up at this time is that they said that it was announced in 1958 on the floor in California that Dr. Kenley said that told about President Kennedy John F. Kennedy would be nominated and elected president, but he would not finish his term in office. And I beg to differ with the people in L.A. because in 1957, when we were fixing up a house for Dr. Kenley, after we had finished that evening, we sat down on boxes, and Dr. Kenley spoke up and said, I want to tell you something here, and this is a prediction. He said, and this was in the year 1957, he said, Humphrey and Stevenson will be in a dead heat in 1960, and a deadlock is for, you know, being nominated for the Democratic ticket. And he says, all of a sudden, out of Massachusetts will come one by the name of John Kennedy, and he is a Roman Catholic, and he will be nominated, and he will be elected president, but he will not finish out his term. Now, those are some of the things, and I'd like to say one other thing that really interests me. I went to a meeting in Cincinnati, Ohio. Well, it was a suburb of Cincinnati called Laughlin. And in this particular room that we were meeting, the room hadn't been cleaned in quite a spell. It was very dirty. And I sat beside Dr. Farley, the one that Dr. Kenley cured of cancer. or in other words, that in Dr. Kennedy, the spirit in Dr. Kennedy. And we were sitting there, and he, at that time, Dr. Kennedy permitted us to smoke. And he dropped his cigarette, and he went down to pick up his cigarette, and he put his hand on the floor, and he showed me the dirt. Dr. Kennedy was on the floor in a white Panama suit. And he got to preaching, and he preached very hard. And he jumped up on the desk, and from the desk he come down, and he rolled on the floor over and over in this Panama suit, white Panama suit. He got up, and there wasn't a bit of dirt on him whatsoever. The suit was not dirty. And I looked at Dr. Farley, and Dr. Farley looked at me as if to say, that can't be. The floor's awful dirty. And when the meeting was over, we went up right to the front and saw that where he had been, it was dirty as all get out. But he had did not, there was no marks where he had been there on the floor either. So those are some of the things that I know about Dr. Kennedy. And I have seen him work with people and read their minds. And I've heard know of one other time that we were in Nida Bell's living room at his sister, and he was going into a subject, and all of a sudden he stopped, and there was a girl that was laying down on the floor, and he looked at her and he says, you better stop doing what you're doing, because if you don't, says something is going to happen dreadfully in your family. And she kept on doing what she was doing, and she had a son, and her husband killed him.
Boyfriend
killed him. So these are things that I know that's happened. And then with one other thing about my sister, and I'll let you tell, well, I'll tell you about that too. But my sister had been coming to class regularly, and her husband made her quit coming. He refused to let her come to class. And so one Sunday evening, Dr. Kennedy was telling me, he says, you know what I want to do? I want to see your sister tomorrow night, she and her husband. I want them to be here at Nida Bell's promptly at 7 o'clock. So I said, well, Doc, I'll tell them, but I said, I don't know whether it will do any good or not. So I told my sister about Dr. Kennedy saying that he wanted to see them the next night. And my brother-in-law would not let her go. Thursday of that week, my sister was placed in the hospital because of a cancer. She had had a cancer removed from one breast, and it had gone to the other breast. And by 1 month from the date of the time that Dr. Kennedy told me he wanted to see her, my sister died. It was in August when Dr. Kennedy had told me that, and in September my sister died. So if thing be that he wanted to take care and he had an unction from Yahweh, I don't know. But because of the disobedience of my sister and brother-in-law, she died. And what was the other one?
Your foot.
Oh, yes. I had a ganglion on the bottom of my foot, and it was between my heel and and the balls of my toes. And it was very painful. A ganglion is sort of a nerve ending, you know, where growth is growing around it. And it's something like we say, a large wart. And when I would step on, if a stone or something, you know, and would go, it would just be terrible. So I had to go to a foot doctor. And the foot doctor was in the east end of Springfield. So after I'd gone to the foot doctor, he said, I'm going to give you a shot. And he said, the shot that I have to give you, he said, is just give you a little relief. It will not cure. I'm going to set you up for an operation. This was on a Tuesday. And he said, I'll set you up for an operation on Friday morning. And he said, now the shot that I'm going to give you is that looked like a fish hook. And he said, I got to get up to the core of it to do you the good to get you, give you any relief. Well, after I had gone to the doctor, I said, I'm out in the East End. I might as well drop off and see Dr. Kinley. So I went over to see Dr. Kinley. And he says, what brings you here? And I said, well, Dr. Kinley, I came here because I had to go to the foot doctor, and I'm going to have an operation Friday. And I said, I really don't want that operation. I said, I've got a ganglion, and it's just hurting me terribly. Oh, he says, is that right, huh? Ha, 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 ha. He laughed. So I go home that evening. The ganglion still hurts. I go to bed that night. The ganglion still hurts. I wake up in the morning, and the ganglion is gone, completely gone. And it was as though that it never was there in the first place. Huh. Now, you can guess as to what happened, or who, if Dr. Kinley took care of it, or that spirit in Dr. Kinley. Dr. Kinley couldn't do anything of himself, because I'd go over to his brother's house, where Dr. Kinley was. And Dr. Kinley and his brother, Benny, were out in the garage, and they were crushing cabbage in order to get the cabbage juice out to help their stomach, which was supposed to help their stomach. And he said, you know, if anybody, he said, I would heal myself, first, last, and always. He said, but I'm helpless unless I have permission from the Father, and the Father doesn't give me permission. So he said, I got to carry this burden all through with me. So these are the things that I know that Dr. Kinley did perform. And he taught the truth, and we stick with the truth. And he said, you go to the law and the prophecies. And he said, I have been sent here at the end of this age to save your soul. Now, not to give you a new soul, but to save your soul.
That's right.
Okay. So that's my announcement.
But Ronnie, you. No, you tell them what you saw.
No, I heard.
Well, one time he lived right down the street from us before he moved to the East End. And I went down to visit one afternoon, and I was just sitting in the living room across from him, like he was there and I was here. And his wife was cooking in the kitchen. And all at once I looked at him, and he appeared as my grandfather. And I looked at him, I said, Grandpa, and I said, you look just like my grandfather. I said, but my grandfather didn't like me. And all through my childhood, I carried in my mind that my grandfather disliked me because he was very strict, you know. So he called me Eve, old Eve. So I said, I told Dr. Kinley that. And then he told me that my grandfather really loved me. He said he was strict because he loved me. And then right after that, he disappeared. There was nothing there but a cloud sitting in the chair. And by rights, I should have ran out the door, but, you know, I didn't. And because of the first thing, my grandfather had died when I was around 12 years old. And I was a married woman, you know, when that happened, when I saw him appear as my grandfather. Then, after he appeared as this cloud, there was just nothing but a cloud sitting in the chair. And then, that disappeared, and he came back to himself. After that, he told me that was an ectoplasmatic emanation. And he said, that can happen to anybody. I've never seen him after he passed, but I've seen him walking. When he was teaching in California, one night before I went to bed, I saw him appear out there in the dining room. So my husband asked him about it because he thought maybe I had hallucinated. So, and he said, well, he thought he would drop in. You know, he was thinking about it, so he thought he would drop in and see us. But we have witnessed how healings of people with cancer. In fact, his sister, Nida Bell, and she had cancer of the uterus, and it disappeared. And so many instances of people being healed. And he treated us with kindness and patience, and he was like a father to us. Now that's what comes to my mind to say. And I'm very thankful that we had the privilege, you know, of meeting him.
And could I add with that, we would ask Dr. Kinley questions. And Dr. Kinley would sometimes go around Robin's barn to answer the question for us. And so we would say, Dr. Kinley, all we want is a yes or no. And he said, I could give you a yes, I can give you a no, but then you couldn't prove how it was a yes or a no. So that's why I have to go the way I do, so that you can understand, a full understanding of it. And one thing I want to add, my brother and I and Dr. Kinley and Dr. Kinley's son, we were going to Cincinnati for a Sunday meeting. Clifford Jr. was doing the driving. My brother was in the front seat with him, and Dr. Kinley and I were sitting in the rear seat. Clifford Jr. was doing the preaching. He was driving the car and doing the preaching and looking back like this.
Who's Clifford?
Clifford Jr., that was Dr. Kinley's son. And he was looking back instead of watching the road. And so we came to this one particular traffic light in a little town, and he just was able to stop at the last minute. And so Dr. Kinley told him, says, Clifford, I want you to shut up, turn around, and do the driving. I am tired of doing your driving for you. So that kind of really stunned me, because I wondered who was doing the driving, because he...
Mom, did you thanks for leaving out.
What?
Things about the healings. You know about your mother.
Yeah. Okay, that
he
came.
He talked to you about it. Mm-hmm.
Yes. My mother, when I was growing up, she had thyroid trouble, and she would always have growths that would grow around her neck and just be like tires, real thick tumors. And she'd have them removed, and then they would grow back. So she'd had the third operation, and the doctor had told her that it was malignant. She'd gone to Catherine Kuhlman in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and other healers. And she said people would, all around her would be healed, but nothing happened to her. So we told her, we'd talked to her before about Dr. Kinley, and we asked her to come here. And so she did. And Dr. Kinley told her she could have the operation and there would be no cancer, or not have the operation and it would go away. Well, she went home and she had the operation, and they had the roots had grown all down her face. She was just black and blue from the roots and down her chest where they pulled these roots. And after after that,
and wrapped around her brain.
Well, anyhow, she came out all right, and she had been a school teacher before she married, but after she married, she raised us, and they didn't hire school teachers, married school teachers back in those days. But she went back to school and got her license renewed and taught after that. So there was no damage done. And she lived to be 96 years old. She just died 2 years ago. So I had thyroid cancer. One morning before I got out of bed, an angel appeared to me, and he just stood over me like this and just put his arms out. And he never said anything, but I just felt love come from him. And then he left, but I knew within myself I was sick, but I had no feelings of illness or anything before that. And I told my husband that what had happened, and he says, well, maybe you'd better go for a checkup. So I went to this surgeon that had operated on him, and he checked me all over, my breast and everything. He said, there's nothing, no lumps, nothing. So I told him about the history of goiter in my family, and he felt all around. He said, you don't look like you have a goiter, but he felt, and he says, well, you do. He said, you have an inward goiter. And so I went in for surgery in April.
April 24th.
And anyway, when they opened me up, they found inside the goiter, there was a tumor.
But on the day she was to be released is when they notified her of such, on May 1st.
They removed the tumor, and I was to be released. And then they came back in and told me that I had cancer. And but the cancer was asleep. It hadn't awakened. And so they removed it, and that was 30-some years ago. So I'm still here, as you can see.
I'm a runny run.
Well,
I'm shy. I have cameras.
That's okay. Just state your name. And
my name is Ron Carr, and I actually was born in this class. Parents would bring me to class as a child, and as all for many children do in the classes, didn't want to hear. I'd be sitting and have my head down like this, looking to the side, looking up around, you know. Or when I had to have schoolwork, I was glad to have schoolwork. So, you know, but after a while, Yahweh put something in me and made me come around, and I started understanding things in class, and then they made me a moderator back in 1966, I believe it was. I was only 16 or 18, something like that, or 64, something like that. Well, anyway, the point that I have, that I experienced with Dr. Kinley, is that my father sometimes critiqued some of my lectures that I would give, and he would always say, he made a comment to me one time. He says, Ron, you have a lot of knowledge, but he says, I don't know if you have any understanding. And what he was meaning by that is that I was pretty good on correlations. I'd go down blood, water, spirit, 40, but I wouldn't actually bring it into reality the way it really is, how it works for each individual soul. So I pondered on this, and then I had an opportunity to go visit Dr. Kinley one evening. And usually there's a house full of people, but this particular evening I think it was someone else and Aunt Nidabelle and he. And then since I wanted to talk to him one-on-one, he I think he asked this person to leave, and I don't remember who this person was. But as I was talking to him, I asked him that question. I said, Dr. Kinley, I thank Yahweh for what he's given me as far as knowledge. But how does one know that one understands the knowledge that one has, or that Yahweh has given him? So as my father has said, that Dr. Kinley always would come forward out with a complete, you know, say yes or no. He'd go around Robin's barn, and you'd be spending 1 to 2 hours, you know, listening to him. And at various times, you could get sidetracked. You could get sidetracked because if you didn't listen to everything he said, you might miss it at the end. You might miss the meaning. Well, from my understanding now through the years, they said that Dr. Kinley always wore socks, even though it was in hot, you know, summertime or what. And well, this particular evening, you know, he had house shoes on. I can't remember whether he took his socks off or he didn't have socks. But he would do some gestures, and when he was explaining to me certain things and about this, and I happened to look down at his hands, and I don't know whether it was the top or the bottom of the hand, but I saw a round circle as if some, you know, he had been punctured and it had healed. You know how things heal and it turns kind of dark, you know. And so, you know, I still didn't, you know, I'm one of the types, you better show me, you know. So then I said, well, let me look down here at the foot. So, you know, I noticed that he didn't have his socks on and he had his feet like this. And I looked down, and as he was talking, and there was a circle down here, down on his feet here, you know. So I wanted to see some more, you know, but I wanted to try to concentrate on what he was saying. And then he flipped his hand over like that. I don't know whether it was this, you know, this way or that, but when he did, I saw it again. And I looked on the other hand, it was the exact same thing, you know. And it seemed like after that point, after I left him, that Yahweh gave me some understanding of what I was preaching off the floor, or the knowledge that I had. And I had, and I'm not bragging, I mean, I believe I did have a great deal of knowledge, because I helped them make pamphlets in the early 70s and what have you. But that bothered me too, and I just wanted to really know, because the understanding of knowledge is actually the Holy Spirit, to be honest with you. And from that point on, I believe that Yahweh enriched my knowledge and understanding, and this is where I am now, you know, today. Still solid in the class, and still attending, and knowing that this is the absolute truth, and that we are blessed beyond measure.
And a lot of things they're saying now, Dr. Kinley never taught. He never taught that we had to, that our soul was not saved. Had to get a new soul and all this embellishment. And he told us to, before he left here, he said, if anyone comes teaching anything other than what I have taught you, let him be accursed.
Hmm.
Now that's what he said.
Tell him about the Sunday before he left for the last time.
And he said he gave us all that we needed.
Did you come to know?
What other three
we
you
were,
sit here?
I can see. We were.
Then this is the Night of Bells.
Night of Bells.
He's fine.
Come on.
Yeah.
No. Ma'am, you go back and sit here.
We were sitting in Night of Bells' yard. Well, had chairs all around and everything. And I was sitting on the left side of Dr. Kinley. And on the other side was Rick Parsley. Those are two, he's a teacher in the school too. Well, anyway, he says, I feel sorry for you people after my departure. He says, I wish I could be here with you. But, he said, I do want you to know, he says, after my departure, grievous wolves shall enter in and spread the flock, or scatter the flock. And he says, I want you to be aware of this, because it's going to happen. And he says, it's not going to be some little a wimp sitting out in the audience. But Dr. Kim said there's going to be some big dog on the floor. Now, those were the comments he made, and I have a witness to it through Rick Foster.
Well, and you have a witness here because I was there.
Were you there?
I was there. We were sitting in the backyard. And I remember looking up at the sky when he was expressing that.
Yeah.
And he was saying that he feels very, he was very, I feel, he said, I feel very sorry for you. I wish you wouldn't have to go through this. What's going to happen?
But I do know of those things that happen. And I might mention something here, which to me kind of hurt my feelings. Dr. Gill had to work when Dr. Harris was here sometime, I think it was in 84. Dr. Gill had to work at night, and he couldn't take him to Cincinnati on a Wednesday night. And he asked me to take him. So I took Dr. Harris, and at the same time, Dr. Harris had brought along with him Roosevelt Beatty. And my brother had gone that night with me to Cincinnati, and my wife. Mm-hmm. And my wife was sitting in the back, and then the next name was next to Murth was Dr. Harris, and on the left side was Roosevelt Beatty. And my brother sat in the front, and I did the driving. Well, anyway, I had asked, after class was over and we were on our way home, I had asked Dr. Harris a simple question. And I don't remember to this day what the question was. Neither does my brother. I would ask him. I said, do you know what that question was? But when I asked Dr. Harris that question, he looked at me and he said, you mean to tell me you've been in this class all this time and you don't know that? Well, all I was trying to get was a verification of whether I was right or wrong in my thinking. So for him, that was one thing that kind of sparked me up to be wary of him, because he and his cohort, Roosevelt Beatty, they just laughed themselves. My wife could tell you they just laughed about it and said, they don't even know that. If I had really known for sure, I wouldn't have asked him. So sometimes some simple things can get past people that they don't understand, that they're trying to get a clear understanding. So that's the way the difference between Dr. Harris and Dr. Kinley was. Dr. Kinley would stay up with you all night long, and he would never insult you in the least.
Never.
Never. I mean, he's very patient with you. And that's one, see, some things that I know that happened. And one other time, we were in the basement of a girl's home, and they invited Dr. Harris there. And Dr. Gill and I were getting into an argument about all the angels sinning. We were arguing with Dr. Harris about all the angels sinning, and Dr. Kinney said all the angels didn't sin.
Now, what year was that, sir?
It was in the year 94 or 95. I can't know exactly what year, either 94 or 95. Mm-hmm. And it was in Cynthia Payne's basement. We'd been invited down there. And anyway, Dr. Harris, when we got to arguing with him, he told Dr. Gill, he says, you know, Dr. Kinley told me you always argued with him. And so I spoke up. I said, now, wait a minute, Dr. Harris. I said, not only did Dr. Gill argue with him, but I said, Dr. Nathan Higgins and Dr. Wilbur Carr always argued with him. I said, now, Dr. Richard Carr never argued with him. I mean, he agreed with whatever he said, but I said,
that's
Nathan and Gil and I, Bert can tell you, we always argued with him about if we didn't understand something.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the things that I know that, and Dr. Harris got a little angry with us because we were asking him questions, you know, about certain things.
I recall reading in a transcript that Dr. Kinley once said, show me a fighter and I'll show you a convert. You know, it seemed to me that he would appreciate
if they would appreciate that, that's for sure. He said, if you keep saying to me that's right, I know you don't know. And he actually proved that one night, didn't he, Marshall? Now, here's what happened on a Sunday night. He spoke, and he said Judas didn't get his feet washed. And everybody in the school said, that's right, that's right, that's right. So I go over to Dr. Kennedy that evening, and we get to arguing. I bet you I argue up to 3 o'clock the next morning. And so when I left, I said, Dr. Kennedy, I said, I want you to know Judas got his feet washed. So Dr. Kennedy got up the next night on a Monday night in class, and he sat down in a chair. And he said, I want to tell you something this evening. I say some things off the floor because I want to find out if you people really know what you think you know.
Or listen to.
Don't just be yesing me just because who I am. He said, but you think the thing through for yourself and see if it's logic. And he said, let's get into the 13th chapter of John. He went into the 13th chapter of John, and he explained how Judas did get his feet washed. He said, now, I said that intentionally last night to see who would give me an argument. And he said, you know, there's only one that gave me that argument. And he said, that was Jack Carr. And he said, he was listening. Mm-hmm. Not that he knows any more than anybody else, but he said, on that particular point, he was listening. He said, I've caught him on other points. But he said, on that, because he did, he caught me on a point, you know, that one time I was on the floor, and I said, how did Yahweh move from pure spirit into that incorporeal spirit, into the intangible sanctuary, and from there he created, from the intangible sanctuary. And Dr. Kennedy called me up to the front. He says, I think, and I went into all about the creation, and Dr. Kennedy says, you did a very good job on the creation, but he said, you made one big error. He said, can I correct you without you getting angry? I said, sure, sure, that's what I'm here for. And he told me, he said, when Yahweh transformed into Yahweh Elohim, and from there into the tabernacle pattern, he said he transformed back into himself. And out of him came the creation. He said, that's why you see I got the picture of that half man there, because the creation came from Yahweh Elohim. So that's why I stand to be corrected.
Since you mentioned that, this question I'd like to ask, this is concerning the part of the textbook called Comparative Exegetical Analysis, where he talks about the hydrogen atom. As I understand it, this is, as I was told by some of the older members back home, that this is the reason why he received a PhD, you know, because of what he had written about there, or if I'm incorrect, perhaps you can explain how that came about?
I don't know anything about that. The only thing that I know that he did tell us about, there were, at that time, 92 mm-hmm. basic elements.
Mm-hmm.
91 of them were threefold,
mm-hmm.
but the hydrogen atom was twofold. And he says, what that is showing the spiritual and the natural.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way he went into that. But as far as any more on that, I don't know. Do you remember when you went?
I seem to remember something about some papers he had done, and I think they were submitted to Wittenberg University or something like that.
Yes,
if you could tell us anything.
I wasn't part of that, but I read the article. My brother was.
Mm-hmm.
And he and Dr. Carl Gross, and I think one of the others, I think, was Dr. Barbie, went over to Wittenberg University with this original, it was in a notebook, and they gave it to this professor, and they asked him, could he simplify it, bring it down into plain terms where they could understand it. And this Wittenberg professor looked at it, and about a week later he returned it, and he said, I can't do anything with it whatsoever. And so then that's why when they put out that little, what color book was
little
that?
Little gray book.
They left it as it was.
Do you remember what year that was?
No, I don't know what year that was. It was in the 40s.
It was in the 40s, okay.
Yes, late 40s.
Mm-hmm.
This was a pamphlet that was put out?
Yes.
That's a little gray pamphlet.
Well, that
went down. the little gray one is the original. The ones that the class has now are.
But his first was in a notebook. He had it in a notebook, and then he put, then they had it put
into
a pamphlet.
In the gray pamphlet. But it's the same.
What it was called?
I have the pamphlet.
I think it was an introduction to something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think we have that.
But it's small, right?
It's small.
Yeah, we got that from Rip Macklin, and he in turn had got it from
gray.
Freddie Allen.
Right,
we had went to Albuquerque last year.
Uh-huh.
And
we went to Albuquerque.
Yeah, we were there, and I was there.
And
Rip had gotten the copy from Dr. Freddie Allen.
Uh-huh.
And we got it from him, and we made copies, and we made it available to our class.
Well, I would like to say, too, in the year 1994, Freddie Allen Jr. was here, and he came to my house, and we sat down, and we talked, and I never will forget how, but all the other people that I had known from California around, they were buying this new stuff that was being presented by Dr. Harris, and after I got through talking to Freddie Allen Jr., he says, you know one thing? I am in complete agreement with you. He says, I don't understand why this is coming out the way it is. He said, it baffles me.
It's a test.
But
it's a test.
It's very baffling.
Well, I wanted to ask you, after he explained all this to you, was it clearer in your mind when you said you have the knowledge but not the understanding?
Not at that moment, but as time went by. But what he said to me at that particular time, I really couldn't see what he was really saying. I really didn't, that actual, conversation. And so then, the only thing I'm thinking about it is that, because I was thinking also, everything happens for a reason,
yeah.
And I'm thinking like, now, why did I see those marks, And I think, what I'm understanding from it is that he was trying to tell me who he really was. That he was, he was the same one that he came in the body of Yahshua Messiah, was that same spirit,
mm-hmm.
And that was him. And he's, like the vision appeared at, with Noah, and he was actually the vision in the second age, and then at the completion of this age here, the vision is coming again and talking, and he's, that was him,
Mm-hmm.
And,
so the holes disappeared? Did you see them disappear?
No, I didn't see them disappear, but I saw, as if they were wounds that had healed in the exact same spot in each, as if, when he was crucified, how he had his feet
right.
like that,
right.
And then he was nailed on the cross like that, so I was very hesitant about saying that to anyone. I only told the class maybe this year, and then maybe 3 years ago I mentioned something slight about it, but because I just wanted to keep that to myself, because I'm one that I don't see things, but I hear things, and something tells me things, and it'll occur, so that, that might be a gift, but that's what he gets. But my mother sees, visions or appearances of things.
Oh yes, she
but everyone has
angels,
a gift,
right.
She said she would see angels quite a bit. We'd go to bed at night, and she would say, "Oh, you see that angel? Oh, that angel there," and so forth. And I got the place, I wanted to go to sleep. I said, "Yeah, I see the angel." But then it got to me one day, and I said, "Dr. Kinley was here." It was in the summertime, and so was Dr. Harris. And so I said, "Murdoch," I said, "I'm going to call Dr. Kinley on this, because I said, I'm going to find out, because I said, maybe I might have to take you out to mental hospital." So then I got hold of Dr. Kinley on the phone, and he said, "Dr. Harris, will you go upstairs and get on the other end?" He said, "I'm going to explain this to Jack." So Dr. Harris got on the other end of the phone, and he said, "Now, Jack," he says, "you have to go to 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter." And he says, "You got to find out." Now, he said, "There's various gifts of the Spirit, of one Spirit." He says, "Whereas you have the gift of knowledge, your wife has the gift of being being able to see things? And he said, yes, they are real to her. And he said, I have myself projected to her, astral projected to her. So then these things are true. And what she sees is true. And people can see invisible angels. There have been a lot of people out that have seen it. And he went to go on and explain about Fatima and all that different stuff. Mm-hmm. And he said people get different interpretations of it. He said that's what makes it wrong.
Well, whenever I would see anything, I would always go to Doc. Mm-hmm. And he would show me where it was in the Bible. And he said, now, if I could find in the law and in the testimony, throw it out as a hallucination.
Mm.
So he always told me, you know, to always check it in the scriptures. So I always have.
You mentioned Fatima. Could you elaborate on that, how Dr. Kinley explained that?
Well, Dr. Kinley says it was just what they had seen.
It was a delusion.
It was a delusion mm-hmm. that was sent to them. And it was just like he said, just like Yahweh has given the devil certain powers. And said, the devil can do things too. That he can do things. He can he can heal.
Mm.
And he said, the devil can prophesy, and they can predict. And he said, there are some devils that can read minds. And he says, but can they do all three things? No, only they're gifted into one. But see, one is for deception. And I remember at this time that he was telling me about Dunninger. You remember Dunninger? He says, anybody in the audience, he says, stand up. I can read your mind. And this Dunninger could. But actually, he said, Dunninger had the power to read minds. But he says, when you see one that can do more than one thing, three things, he said, now look, that's a confirmation of the truth. You follow me? And he said, I only know one that ever could do those things, and that was Dr. Kinley.
And Dr. Kinley could talk to you telepathically, too. I mean, to be in a whole room of people, because it happened to me, and I know the other people never heard, but he would talk to you. And he wouldn't move his lips. It was just like... what do you call it?
Ventriloquist.
And I know one time a bunch of us ladies went down in the afternoon to visit Dr. Kinley. And Mary Gross was there. And he told Mary, and nobody heard it, but I heard it. He said, Mary, go upstairs and get the Bible. But he didn't move his lips, nothing. She got up, went upstairs, got the Bible, and brought it down. But he did a lot of things that, you know, was abnormal.
I had a question. When you said he appeared to you, what was that called? Astral projection?
Astral projection, yes.
But
that was ecto.
Ectoplasmic. Oh, okay.
Emanation.
You saw him physically there, or was it like in a vision like type?
But just like he disappeared, like the gentleman there would just disappear, and would be nothing there but a cloud sitting instead of his body. I saw this cloud, and you know, cloud is what led Moses and mm-hmm. led the children of Israel out. And see, that's what really Dr. Kinley. In this last day, I don't mean Dr. Kinley, I'm talking about Yahshua and him, came to do.
And you know,
he will come in clouds. That's our clouds.
Could I say this one here? This is one that's going to be hard to believe. Back in the year 1958, we were having a terrible time here in Springfield.
I'll stand in front of it.
When Dr. Kinley had gone to California and he had left his son Clifford Jr. in dean, in a deanship, or we'll say in charge of the class. And somehow Dr. Clifford Jr. went off base, and he was had this what you call 901 South Yellow Springs Street. Dr. Kinley and them had purchased the building at 901 South Yellow Springs Street for people that were wayward and stuff like that, or where wives had been driven out of their homes by their husband because they come to class, or vice versa. And anyway, Clifford Jr. had taken advantage of the situation, and he had left in the house, he had left Boot Strotter and Rachel Strotter, which Rachel was his daughter, to take care of 901 South Yellow Springs Street. So they couldn't stand what was going on over there any longer, because it was terrible things, because he had said that all the women had to come to him to be saved. And
a
strong delusion had come to him. A lot of people were taken in by it. And this one morning, they moved in with us. And this one morning I was getting ready to go to work, and all of a sudden I broke down crying, and I just couldn't keep from crying. And so they brought me down the stairs and laid me on the couch, was right here at this window, not this couch, but another couch. And I had passed out. And I don't know, I was out for some 8 hours. And they said I was breathing and everything was normal. But what had happened when I passed out, I dreamed, or I saw, I was in a beautiful garden. Never seen a garden like that before in my life. It was a rail tracks down there, and I was on a flatbed rail car. And the thing was tipping to one side, and I would try to tip it back so it would be even. And it would tip to the right, and I'd try to tip it back. And then something came to me and said, only I can right the thing. Only I can make it straight. And then, along about that time, there was a head of Dr. Kinley came through that window. And I don't know, I was asleep, or I would, my eyes were closed, and he glued his forehead, just his head, and he glued his forehead to mine. And I was out for some 8 hours, and I come to, and I told other people about it. They said, it looked like you were in a nice dream or something. Said you were just sleeping there just peaceably. So I said, okay, I'm going to ask Dr. Kinley about this. I said, I'm going to have to call him. So we called Dr. Kinley, and Dr. Kinley says, yes, I did, Kane, I visited you, and I'll tell you what time it was. It was 2:00 in the afternoon. I was sitting in the Hotel Algiers. The room was dark, and I was looking out the window, and I astral projected myself to you. And didn't we tell us that murder? Yes, sir, he said, I astral projected myself to you.
But we were tore up at that time.
We were tore up at that time about what was going on at 901. So what we're saying, what is happening now, has happened over and over again in this class. And that's why we, at one time, we had over, here in Springfield, Ohio, we had over 350 members. We had big shots that were in the class. We had lawyers. We had morticians. And we had a car dealer, didn't we? A new car dealer, Ripley. We just had a lot of people. We had lawyers in here. And they believe what we were teaching, but when all this 901,
Dr. Robinson,
mm-hmm. Yeah, Dr. Robinson, we had all this 901 South Yellow Springs, when that broke out, why the people just scattered. Mm-hmm. And after the 70 souls went to California in October, there was only about 10 or 11 people back here that was left, you know, to keep the class going. And then Dr. Kinley sent his son, Glenn Kinley, back here. when Glenn Kinley came back here, he kept the class going good for about the first year. He did a wonderful job. And but then all of a sudden, women got the best of him. Hmm. And then we finally had to, Dr. Carl Gross and Dr. Kinley had to remove him, send him back out to California. And that is when Dr. Gill was put in charge and made the dean here in the state of Ohio. And Dr. Kinley had always wanted me to go to California, but I kind of balked at it. I didn't want to go. So in the year 1963, I had promised him that I was going to California. I had gotten ready. At the time, it was Mitch, Burbank Mitchell, Freddie Allen Jr. were here, and they were in a station wagon. So I decided I would go back with them. And I had gotten into the station wagon. I had sat in the back. When we got across the Mississippi River there in St. Louis, and we were in the downtown section, we got on to Route 66, we had to slow down. I threw my suitcase out the window, and I jumped out the rear Fuchko door, off into the brush, and they didn't know anything about it for about an hour and a half. Mitch was driving, and Freddie Allen Jr. had gone to sleep. Mm. Okay. So then when they woke up and they said, oh my gosh, where is he? But I caught a bus and came back to Springfield. Dr. Kinley had told my wife, said, don't you worry, he'll be back sooner than you think. And I appeared over at Benny's. I kind of drove over to Benny's, and Meredith happened to be there with, Benny was out in the yard, and you said June was out there, Dr. Gill was out there in the yard. And so then he said, I see, I told you, Meredith, he'd be back sooner than you think. So we were sitting there, and he says, I want to tell you something. You are determined to stay here in Springfield. So if you are, here's what I demand of you. I have put my spirit in Dr. Oliver Gill, and I want you to hold up his right arm.
He said he'd be just like him sitting here.
So these years that he has been here, he's been faithful.
Yes, he has. And stuck to the truth.
So what? And he's never wavered, and he'll tell you at the drop of a hat if you ask him a question. And he doesn't know the answer, he won't fumble. He'll say, I don't know. Yeah, he won't try to answer or anything like that. He'll just say, I don't know. And I remember a lot of times he'd say, maybe one of the other teachers, if they can answer, get up and answer. And some sometimes would, and sometimes others wouldn't. But Gil was very honest about the situation. If he didn't know the answer to something, he would say, I don't know. And that's what I admire about him. And I've heard others go, when a question would be asked them, they'd go way off in dreamland or something. They couldn't prove it. So. So I'm very proud to have met Dr. Kinley. And as a man, I know that Yahweh, the Holy Spirit, got into him and gave him that divine vision and revelation. And he stuck to the truth. He never wavered one way or the other. It wasn't one time one way and next time another way.
Or two batches of angels.
Yeah, that's the way it is. Do you still get revelations from him, or do you still see him? Do you still see the angels?
Occasionally, yes.
And are they Dr. Kinley communicating
to
you?
I don't see Dr. Kinley. I see Yahshua when he appears to me. And I have seen him, you know, those circles and the chart. I've seen those. It's alive. It's real. I mean, that then the end, where he and all the angels are gathered around him. And then I've had questions in my mind, and he has appeared to me and gave me the answer, even natural things, even about buying another home, because there were another house that we wanted so bad, and Yahshua appeared to me in a vision and said, I just saw it like in my head. And he said, don't buy that house. He said, if you do, you'll have a lot of trouble. So my dad came up to tell him what happened.
About 3 or 4 months later, her dad came up, and I wanted to show her dad the house that we were going to buy. And at the time, we were within about $3,500 of agreeing to buy the house. And anyway, when we drove past the house, the front yard was all dug up. The great big ditch was two ditches, one on one side of the yard, on the other side of the yard, where there must have been either the water line or the gas line or something, was all messed up. So that was the reason why that we weren't supposed to buy that house.
But, I mean, he makes you know that he's ever present, that he's right within you. And you really don't have to follow a man, but you be obedient to those that have rule over you if they are teaching the truth. But if they stray, you know, you got to know when they stray. But it's only Yahshua that can keep you on the right track. And that's why you had what you had too, because we didn't know, we were so torn up that we didn't know which way, you know. We didn't want to quit class, and we didn't. So he said he was like on a railroad car, but it's, Yahweh said he'd lean to the right and he'd lean to the left, but he said only Yahshua would keep it straight, or Yahweh, you know. So that's what, that was the meaning of what you saw. But I mean, even though man leaves you, Yahweh, he doesn't leave you.
Well, I might tell you about one other thing too. Because all this goes together with Dr. Kenning. My brother-in-law was on his way home from work, and he worked in down here in Fairborn, or the Wright-Patterson Air Base, and he happened to notice that Dr. Kenning was driving the car in front of him, and Dr. Kenning sped quite a bit because he had to go from city to city. He was an inspector in this insurance business, and he didn't have much time. If he wasted too much time one place, then he had to hurry up and go to this other place. So Jack thought that he would keep up with, that was my brother-in-law, he thought that he would keep up with Dr. Kenley. So Dr. Kenley had got up to close to 100 miles an hour in the car, and all of a sudden, he had a flat tire in the front. And I said, no, if you have a flat tire on your front, and going 100 miles an hour, there's no chance that car will turn over on you, because you can't steer it. You can't hold on to it. And they said, Jack Richards, my brother, which should have been something to him then at that time, that he should have come to class. He said he brought that car to a stop, and it never wavered or anything like that. He just brought it right to a stop. The doctor, my brother-in-law, Jack, for Ralph Richardson, he said, oh my gosh, he says, I thought you, that was the end of you. Dr. Kennedy says, no, says, I've got more work to do. So then he helped him fix his flat tire, and he'd come on in Springfield.
So the car just kind of rolled to a stop after that?
Yeah, just come and pulled it right over to a stop. And he's been going 100 miles an hour and had that flat tire. The blowout.
Could you explain maybe some prophecies that you know of, or how, you know, certain prophecies that Dr. Kenley made? You explain one about John F. Kennedy. Do you know anything about the Rosenberg's prophecy?
No.
Well, any others that you know of?
No, no, I think most of those are made in California.
I see.
Outside of the one about the Korean War.
Yeah, go ahead, please explain that one.
The way that I understand that now, I wasn't too well informed in the class.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'd go into the class occasionally. I wasn't what you call a steady goer. But that he had come through Springfield, and this is one of the things that made his brother believe in the truth. Bob Kennerly.
Mm-hmm.
He had told Bob Kennerly, he said that by the next time that he came into Springfield, which would be around about 40 days later, Korea and the United States would be at war. Murth, was it Vietnam or the Korean War?
I believe it was Korean War.
Was it Korean War? Okay, yeah. But anyway, Dr. Kennedy says, now, if it doesn't happen, and this was put in the Springfield newspaper, mm-hmm. Bob Kennedy, he wanted that put in the Springfield newspaper, that he made that statement. So then when he came back into Springfield, the FBI wanted to check him out.
Mm-hmm.
To find out how did he know that there was going to be a war. What gave him the idea? Because the war had broken out by the time he'd come back to Springfield. So he was checked out. And
they were satisfied with his answer?
No, they'd always, and another thing, the FBI checked him out several times.
Oh, really?
He was in California because of the predictions he had made. And they wanted to know how did he know these things. And they couldn't understand it, you know. But they could never arrest him on anything because he said Yahweh had given him permission to say these things and predict these things. Because at the time it should be known that some people needed to be confirmed in the gospel or in the truth. So basically he wanted people to understand, and when it seemed like he would always say, there's going to be a special meeting, and you'll hear me say goodbye. He said, I want you to bring your friends and your enemies to the next class that we hold our next meeting. And we said, oh boy, we're going to get something new here. Something's going to come out of the blue, you know. And Dr. Kennedy, when he'd get on the floor, it was just the very same old thing, blood, water, spirit, 40, death, burial, resurrection, you know, carnal ordinances. And that's what he would go into, because he knew that that's what the new people needed to know if they come to class. They had to know the basics in order to understand any more. And that's how we drew quite a few people into class. And it's just the simplicity of the gospel. Now, Dr. Kennedy, I'll tell you this. Dr. Kennedy says, remember, it's A, B, C.
Mm.
He says, always be certain. He said, it's not A, B, C, D. He says, altering brings certain death.
Mm.
So, I always remember that. A, B, C, and he said, A, B, C, D. Altering brings certain death. So, these were the things that I know of him, and he was precious to me. And we came back, and when he died, they brought his body back, and I had sent a letter out to all the schools that we make a monument for him, you know, that they donate money. And he jumped all over me, even from Freddie Allen Jr. Says, what, that's carnal. Says, what do you want a monument set up for him for? And all that kind of stuff. And but finally the people, they donated the money for, you know, for what you call it. And then we had X number of dollars left over. And we asked Dr. Harris, what should we do with the number of what the money we had left over? And he said, well, if you know how it was dispersed to you by branch, give it back to them accordingly, y'all, percentage of, and that's what we did. But, and then we had someone to go out there after we had put the dates of his birth. And they changed it, didn't they, Ronnie? What was it, from 1895 or something like that to 1896?
That just happened within the last 3 years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They chiseled it out and tried
chiseled
to write
it
back
out.
In with a permanent marker.
Yeah. So we don't know who did it, whether it was Loopy's class that came up, or Wally Brett,
have a
or
problem with that 1930, 31
vision. It was around the time they were up, because Carla's doing a family history, and we went out there, and we was actually looking at some of the other stones that were in the same burial plot, some of the other family of Dr. Kinley, and so we weren't paying attention to Dr. Kinley's gravestone, so she was taking pictures of the others, and Elizabeth Oates and some others. So we were getting back in the car to leave, and I turned around and looked. And I just seen something that was stood out on the stone. What is that? We went and looked. That's when we noticed that someone had carved out the five and made it into a six.
Made it into
and
a six.
Like,
and did you ever notice that out there around the people that was buried around him, now what was the name of one? One
Jordan.
Was named Jordan. And another was named Ford, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it was the Jordan River and it was Ford. Ford, you know, when you Ford a river. So it's really, you know, strange when you see those things like that. And maybe they're just little coincidences.
About your father.
Yeah, I was going to get to him. He realized it or not, I was going to get to him.
I had a question for you, Jack. You said that lady was laying on the floor, and he told her not to, whatever she's doing, to stop doing that. Was that my aunt?
That's right.
Was it?
Well, what was she doing?
I didn't want to mention names.
I'd never heard that before.
Yeah.
And what was she doing on the floor that he wanted her to stop?
No, it wasn't what she was doing on the floor. It was some things she was doing in her
personal
life.
Oh, things she was into.
In her personal
life. Oh, I see.
But this is one thing I want you to know too. Now, this was stated, and Dr. Harris was in the room, I don't care what anybody says. This was in the year 1975. Dr. Harris was sitting in Nida Bell's living room. He was sitting by the TV, and Murdoch and all of us were gathered around, and Dr. Kinley was sitting in his chair over here in the corner by the piano. And we had asked about his brother, his brother who was mentally retarded from birth. Was he saved? Is he lost? Because of the fact, it says back in Psalms, says, I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Dr. Kinley spoke up and said, now when was that said? And we said, well, it was said under the law. And David said it under the law, didn't he? He said, now, what you've got to see is that Yahshua wiped the slate clean. And when a child is born, he was born just like Adam was born in the Garden of Eden, innocent. So you're not born in sin and shaped in iniquity in this age.
Yeah, I think he mentioned something about the age of accountability.
Yeah, age of accountability, right. But he said, what happens? He said, now what happens after a child is born is what the parents feed the child or the environment of the child. They get around other people and so forth and so on, and whatever the religion is the parents have, and they might sprinkle the guy, you know, kid with water and all that kind of stuff. And so he gets into an environment, what you call a natural environment, and he learns natural carnal ordinances, and he's lost from that point on. But Yahweh takes care. He said the abortions and all that stuff, all of them are saved, or the retarded children. And Yahweh taking care of them, they will be saved. He said, it's you who have the right mind, or you got a mind where you can know right or wrong to understand these things. When you come to this school, he said, because when you come in here, He said, "Now, you didn't come, you wasn't born with a carnal mind, a satanic spirit, and physical body." Mm-hmm. He said, "This is the way you come into this school. You come in here with a carnal spirit, a carnal mind, and a physical body." He said, "Now, what happens if you learn the truth?" He said, "The spirit of Yahweh gets into you. The satanic spirit leaves, and then this it gets into your soul, and there's an exchange made, or you it's a regeneration or a renewing of your mind, and you don't get a new soul. Mm-hmm. It's just that it's been changed.
It's a translation.
Yes, transformed from a carnal to a spiritual." So how they get all this stuff that they're saying now, you see, there's no basis for it. You can't even prove it with a pattern. Mm-hmm. You know, they go according to the pattern. They'll hit a little bit of blood, water, spirit, and 40. They'll hit death, burial, and resurrection. Then they come off on this new stuff, which has nothing to do with what they had said previously. Mm-hmm. Just like they said, this is a great vision and revelation given to our founder, Dean Dr. Henry Clifford, the Americans, mm-hmm. and how the Yahweh step got into that body. Well, the thing of it is, there's the Holy Spirit that got into him. Because if you say, "Oh, well, Yahweh got into him," that leaves you and me out. Mm-hmm. You follow me? So the Holy Spirit got into him, and he was one to close out this age. And he actually did. I mean, he did his job. And as we found out that the age did close in 1960, mm-hmm. and that we're in a probationary period now. So, but this comes with diligent study and praying for an understanding of the truth, because you won't be deceived that way. But your closest friend could lead you off. That's why you can't even pay any attention to your closest friend. You must know it for yourself and not for another. Now, you said you had something to say.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to know about your father, if you want to kind of...
Well, I mean, I was just a child when this happened, so the only thing I can say is...
Do you know how your father came to class?
I think it was in 1966, 1967.
Why don't you tell your name and your father's name.
My name is Dana Davis, member of the Springfield class, born and raised. And my parents are Richard and Lorraine Davis. I think my father came to school in 1966, I think. And he was working out at Speco, which later turned to Grable Aerospace. But Frank Gross was working out there at the time. And Frank is the son of Carl F. Gross. And he's actually still a member of the Springfield class here. And they just, work on the job together, talking, and dad started coming to class. And I'm thinking it's 66 or 67, somewhere around there, because I think it was the I was born in 73, because I was about a year and a half old when he had his accident. And I think it was a 75 convention that he was trying to attend.
74.
Okay. State
convention.
It was a state convention. Mm-hmm. And everything that I know about it is from the eyewitnesses that were there. And I know that Dr. Gill and Dr. Bob Buffington was actually there when Dr. Kinley went to visit my dad. But what I do know is that the dad was, he owned a garden. Garden plot out by his job, and he rode a motorcycle, and he told my mom that he was going to go out and see about his garden. So he went out there, and I don't know how long he was out there, but when he left the garden, he was heading back home, and he went. He said later on that he had a small voice that told him not to go this certain way, that he was going to go the other way, but he didn't listen. So he went on the way that. The voice said not to go, and a station wagon pulled out right in front of him, and he broadsided it. And there happened to be a police officer that was there on the scene, and he's actually seen it happen. So he said there was no way he could have stopped. He said that station wagon just pulled out right in front of him. So when when he impacted the side of the station wagon, the now I don't remember if he had a face shield on his helmet or the old motorcycles that had the glass, you know, mounted in front for the, like a bug shield. But one of the two, when he hit the side of it, he went over the bike, which pulled the handlebars straight forward. My mom still has pictures of the motorcycle. And when he went over, the glass, either from the face shield or from the bike, one caught him right here and basically peeled his face back.
Mm.
So, and then when he went over the station wagon, they had them metal luggage racks on top of him back then. And he caught his mouth right on it and ripped his mouth, his teeth right out of his mouth, and just shattered his whole face. So he flipped over, went into the ditch, and of course, from the impact of bringing the tearing, he just tore the whole front of the bike off with his body. And his pelvic arch was shattered. You know, he was really messed up. And at that time, Dr. Kinley, from what I understand, was out fishing. He was out fishing with Lamar Rhodes and I think Larry Dent.
I think it was those two.
Okay. And I remember Lamar, he's also still a member here in Springfield. He said that when they were out fishing, he mentioned about Dr. Kinley fell and hit the ground real hard. And he said he got up and said, "We got to go." He said they left and they went back to Aunt Nida Bell's house. And as soon as they walked in the door, he said Aunt Nida told Dr. Kinley, he said, Dr. Richard Davis has been in an accident. And Lamar said he heard Dr. Kinley say, "I know," and kind of just passed it off. And he said, and Nida repeated it, said, "Dr. Kinley, Richard Davis has been in a really bad accident." And he said, Lamar said that Dr. Kinley spoke up and said, "Nida, I know," and went on. And now I don't know how much time, from the time he actually had the accident to the time that they went out to visit with him. But I know that he was in a coma, and he was totally out of it. They said that, I remember Dr. Gill said that when they went out to see him, that he was just unrecognizable. They said he was just, his body was contorted, his face was, I mean, you imagine his teeth were wrapped in his face, they had to sew his face back together, and his, I mean, down here, he was just shredded, they had to sew him all back together, you know, he was really in bad shape. And from his injuries, he should have been put in a body cast, and been in a body cast for a year, and would have taken him another year to learn how to walk again. And it's funny because here about 5 years ago, I worked with this guy who was in an almost identical accident that happened to my dad. And I just got to talking to him and, you know, motorcycles, and he mentioned the accident. And he said when he was out in California and he was going down one of the curvy roads on a mountainside or something, mm-hmm. and he was coming around this bend and this semi was in the lane and he couldn't swerve. One way he went off the cliff, the other way he went right into the to a concrete wall or something. So he chose a wall. And he had a shattered pelvic arch, face was all just like my dad. And I asked him, I said, "How long did it take you to heal?" He said, "Man, I was in a body cast. It took me a year to get out of the body cast. Took me another year, just like what should have happened to my dad." So he's in the hospital, and I know the actual event about when Dr. Kinley went up with Bob Buffington and Dr. Gill is really best for them to say it. Especially, I think Bob Buffington, it really was an emotional event for him because they talk about how that when they went up to go see Dad, he was like in the middle. They was in what do you call that when someone's in critical condition?
Intensive care.
In the I think it was in community hospital or Mercy.
Mercy.
It was in Mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And they have it like in a circle, you know, and have all the patients around and then the nursing station right in the middle so they can get to everyone quickly. Well, they had Dad right beside the nursing station. You know, he was in that bad of a shape. And so Dr. Kinley went up and they said, "We're here to see Richard Davis." And the nurse said, "Well, I'm sorry, you can't speak to him. He, you know, he's in a coma." So they went over to see Dad and they describe it as that he was just concentrating down on Dad. And then he started staring up and he said, "Oh, I didn't know we had company." And when I asked Dad about it, he said it was like that he was just in a peaceful state. Just love, peace, no negativity at all. And he said that when he was in this state, that he could feel something pulling at him and disturbing that peace. And this is when he was coming out. And when he finally came to, he had a problem months after, because I know there was a letter that had went out through the school saying how Dad basically was instantly healed, back to normal, just like that. But, you know, there's some things when Yahweh deals with you, you know, it's a life-changing experience. I know it was for him. And he said, Mom was telling me how that he was really angry for a while after he had been brought out, because he didn't want to leave you from where he was. Mm-hmm. And I know as a kid growing up with him in the house, I mean, that's all he ever talked about. And I used to joke that he had a, he was real bold. He was, you know, he was speed. He just like had a death wish. It seemed like he didn't care about dying. That's just how he seemed to be. But, and it amazed me that, I don't know if you think, if someone's in a coma or like Lazarus when he was dead, where in the world do you go to find them to bring them back from death or back from coma? And that's where Dr. Killian went to get him from, in the spirit with Yahweh. And so anyway, he's in the hospital. He's become conscious. And I know when Dr. Killian was leaving out, he leaned back over to the nurse and said, oh, I thought you said we couldn't speak to him. and I think Dad told Dr. Killian that he wanted to make that convention. Would you say it was a 74. Dad said he wanted to make that convention. And I think it was 2 weeks. The convention was 2 weeks away from the time that he was brought out of this coma. Mm-hmm. Now, he's supposed to have he has a shattered arch. I mean, he's just totally, he should be in the hospital for a year. And Bob Buckton said he saw x-rays of my dad's jaw. You know, you take that kind of force enough to rip the teeth out of your mouth. And he said his jaw was just shattered, like you would take a glass and throw it on the ground. And he said, but they never wired his jaw shut. They never did anything to him. They said that in the x-ray, you can see everything where it was shattered, but it was like put back together. But you could still see all the where it was shattered. But he never had to have his jaw wired shut or anything. Then his pelvic arch, of course, he's supposed to be bedridden. And I don't know why at the time they didn't put him in a cast yet. But somebody told me they went out to visit with him.
I went out to visit. We went out on Thursday.
Okay.
He was not supposed to get out of bed or anything. And we went into the room, and he wasn't in bed. So we asked, you know, the other person was in the other bed, where was he? He said, he's in the restroom. I said, restroom? Why, how can he walk? And the nurse come around and finds him, what's he doing? Says, he can't get out of bed. And he was going into the restroom. He said he couldn't wait on them to come, you know.
He had to go.
Yeah,
somebody
he had
said
to go.
He run to the bathroom and run back and jump in bed real quick so the nurses wouldn't see him. He was supposed to be in bed. And for a long time, I would think about, you know, why would Dr. Kinley do these things like healing and other things in the school? And I always think with that episode, I think about what happened with Lazarus. And I know for me, it gets your attention. I mean, that's an amazing thing for someone to go through something that physically traumatic. And then 2 weeks later, they walk out of the hospital and go to, he wasn't even in the hospital 2 weeks, was he?
I don't think he was.
But he made that convention.
12 days.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's unreal.
Yeah.
So you know that there was something beyond his body being able to heal in that amount of time.
Yeah.
And to me, Dr. Kinley, the spirit through Dr. Kinley, did those things to get the people's attention, to show that what that spirit was. And then once he has your attention, now he can get you into a position where he can preach to you.
Yeah.
Because that's what's, even though he healed my dad still was subject unto coming to school and to learning and being obedient to the gospel just like everybody else. So he was no more, as a man or any of these people that have been healed, any more special than anyone else, but it's just that Dr. Kim or Yahweh through Dr. Kim chose to use them as a witness. That's how I see it.
Mm-hmm.
to build up our faith, all our faith.
Me and all of us.
So your father had no pain when he came out of the school?
No, he had pain. Yes, he did. He was blind for, I think it took him, I don't know how long to gain his sight back. And even up until he died, he still had partial blindness in one of his eyes. But I know Mom told me she would take him up and down the alley and try to get him used to seeing again because he couldn't see. So she would let him practice driving up and down the alley. So he still had some healing to go through, you know. It wasn't like he was just snapped back together, but, you know. Because I mentioned a little earlier, I remember a letter had gone out from the school some years ago saying how the dad was basically just instantly back to normal. It wasn't like that.
No.
And Mom even said that, and his family too, said that he wasn't the same person. They said, well, ever since that happened to him, you know, his family that doesn't come to class, my family doesn't come to class, they'll say, ever since Richard had that accident, he's never been the same person. I said, well, I agree with that. But he's different in a way that you don't know about. But Bob Buffington and Oliver Gill were actually there when that event happened, so they would probably be able to better tell you about it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Carr, what did Dr. Kinley preach as far as like, okay, like your wife was talking about how she saw the apparition of her grandfather, you know, what did he preach about as far as like when people die and where souls go, you know, if you know or you don't know, you know, things like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, he said that my understanding, now this is not on the floor, but he would talk to us, you know, out Nightingale's home. He said what happens to a person, we all, when you die, from a natural standpoint, you fall asleep. And it's just like Adam was put to sleep, and Eve was taken from him. Well, Yahweh knows how to give you that anesthetic to keep you in a deep sleep until the consummation. Instantaneous revelation.
Okay, now, is this in general, or is this for people who don't know, but people who do know, you know, the gospel? I mean, you know, and you know.
But you still are put both are placed to sleep, and we have to go to 1 Corinthians 15th chapter, and where it says about the 25th, says all things is going to be gathered together. That's he said everything is going to be gathered together back into Yahweh Elohim or Yahshua. And then there comes the separation. There comes what you call those that go. He said even the devil goes back. But all goes back to Yahweh. That's where they come from.
Mm-hmm.
But then the others will spend eternity, eternal damnation in the lake. Or the others will be, after they're gathered back into Yahweh Elohim, he'll give them the keys, he'll turn the keys back over to the Father, so that even the Son will turn everything back over to the Father. And then, he said, we'll decide what we're going to do in the ages to come. And we will know where we have been, where we were in the beginning. We will know more things, but we will be learning in the ages to come. Yeah. But we'll decide what we're going to do, he said.
I remember reading a transcript once Dr. Kinley stated that once we get to the sabbatical age, we'll be able to look back and be able to appreciate why Yahweh even made a creation in the first place.
Yeah, right.
And I wanted to say something. You were talking about that rest. Talking about my dad's accident, I remember he told me, and I think he said it off the floor too, that he wouldn't ask Dr. Kinley about that rest, or that he described it as a heavenly state, pure love, joy, you know, that place that he didn't want to leave from. And he asked Dr. Kinley about it, and Dr. Kinley told him that that wasn't even worthy to be compared of the glorification that we all have waiting for us.
Yeah. Either he, you know, immortal damnation or immortal glorification.
until that time, like for example, even the ones that have passed on, your relatives, you know, where you, well, they're all asleep. Mm. Yeah, that's what he says. It's like it's put under an anesthetic.
So, then that brings me to this question then. In the scriptures, where it talks about how Saul went to the witch of Endor, and he entreated her to bring up Samuel the prophet, what was, I don't know, if you could explain that, or if Dr. Kim even mentioned that, or?
No, I don't remember that.
Okay.
I'm going into that.
But he says, what? He said, now, what you have to do, he said, all things are explained by the natural. He said, now, if you go back to the first day, said the light was divided from the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
He said, now that's what has to come about at the end. The light's going to be separated from the darkness. Mm-hmm. So that's the best way I can tell you. And so after that has happened and transpired, then that light will go back from whence it came.
Mm-hmm.
So the darkness is cast, I guess, into outer, what you call outer darkness, or we'll say condemnation.
Subdued, put under his feet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then, I love that. That's in 1 Corinthians, it says that when all things are subdued and put under his feet, then even the Son itself must be made subject.
Yeah.
And then Yahweh might be all in all.
Yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm. Were the people in L.A. aware that Dr. Kinley had said he would leave the spirit with Dr. Gill?
I don't know.
But he told you that this specific.
Dr. Gill doesn't want to take credit.
Dr. Gill doesn't want to take credit.
We've mentioned this a few times.
He told me
he'll make motions like this, like he doesn't.
He
doesn't want credit
for. I'd be so, because he doesn't want credit for anything.
But he may have no choice. I mean, he has no choice, really, right? I mean, whether credit or not.
He just would rather
he wants to leave him out.
He wants to be in the background. He wants everything to be seen as Yahshua the Messiah, the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. But didn't Dr. Kinley take you and your brother Nathan Higgins and Dr. Gill up to Columbus and had a meeting up there?
Yeah.
And how'd that go?
Oh yeah. Oh, that was when he ordered his son to return to California. Didn't he? And at that time, as we were coming out the door, we were on the porch of this particular building, and he says, Nathan, Oliver, or he called him Oliver, but he said, Oliver Gill, he says, Jack Carr and Richard Carr, said, come here, stand here before me. And he says, you now have the charge over the state of Ohio, and especially in Springfield, Ohio, to preach the gospel. Be instant in season, out of season, rebuke, reprove, whatever is necessary, you do. And he told, at that time, he did not beat Gill as being the dean. But this was in June, and then it was in September that Dr. Gill went out to California, and that's when he told Gill that he was to be the dean here in Ohio, made him dean. But he appointed, yes, us four at that time, and he said, now as time goes on, you'll have other teachers. Now he said, what I want you to do, he said, I want you to go throughout Ohio and spread the gospel. He said, set up schools. And when you set up these schools, after you set them up and you've got people that can handle it, handle the jobs, as you come back to Springfield, and that's where you're supposed to stay. He said, now if you want to go visit once in a while, that's all right, you can go visit. But he said, it's not necessary. But the thing that he told Gil after he made him dean, he said, whenever you go somewhere and if you have to do any chastising, take a witness or two with me. And Gil would always take me whenever he had, had to go somewhere. And he'd go chastise a dean or some teacher or something, or saying something from the floor he shouldn't. So, and he
And I don't care how big you were or how little you were, Dr. Gill, he would get right in your face. And that's what I admired about him. He wasn't afraid of whether, you know, the man was big or small or what. He would tell the man whether he's right or wrong, whatever he was doing, to stop. You know, when you have to give credit where credit is due, I mean, as far as the man is concerned. But I know that with the spirit that Dr. Kinley said, I have put my spirit in him. So I have seen that spirit work down through the years that I've been in school. I've gotten angry with Dr. Gill. And as a matter of fact, several times my wife can tell you, I quit. I call myself quitting. And I never will forget one time Ruth Cobb came over here one day and she told me, she said, Jack, you're supposed to be back in that school. And she said, you know what you're going to have to do? I said, what's that? She said, you have to put your boots on and wade through all that stuff. Because the gospel is taught there. So I got back to school. Yeah.
Were you on
so
that? So go ahead, sir.
Well, prior to the times that we live in now, Dr. Kinley had, did he made any prophecies, you know, besides the school dividing among itself and the times that we live in now in this new age or new millennium?
No, I don't know of any.
You were on one of the peace missions, were you?
No.
You were not on none of the peace missions.
I didn't get to go on the peace, the last peace mission, the second one, not the last one, because Dr. Kinley, he was living at that time. He wanted my brother to go, and so he made this, which really hurt me. It hurt me to this day when I think about it. My brother said, now, I can't go. My brother said he couldn't get off work, but he said, my brother Junior can go. Said he can go. Says Dr. Kinley said, well, anybody can go on the peace mission if they got the money. And that kind of hurt me because see that they were supposed to pay for the peace mission for all those who went on the peace mission. So in the place of Richard, and Bob Kennerly was chosen to go. So that's how that was done.
Anything in particular Dr. Kinley mentioned after, well, I guess I'm curious about the first peace mission, because that was the one he went on personally. Was there any particular thing that he emphasized afterward, or?
No, the only thing that I heard about that first peace mission, that Dr. Kinley stood on this hill, and he raised his arms up and said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Now, that's the only thing that I know. I mean, they visit the other places. But he had said, now, prior to on those peace missions, he was leaving Springfield one time in the fall to get back to school for, you know, for his kids. He made the statement in the airport on our way down to where you get onto the land, I mean, to where you get onto the plane. He said, I am going overseas. He says, and we are going to go right up into that bastard's face. And all these people were around, you know, coming and going like that. And he was almost hollering. I'm oh my goodness. He said, I'm going to tell him. But he never got to actually his face, but he got to one of his cohorts and told them, you know, his cardinal, what was his name?
I forget myself. It was the Pope's secretary, personal secretary.
Yeah. I see you use the true name there. He said, yeah. He said, well, why don't you use it?
Cardinal was
it? And they came in the front door and had to go out the back door.
Mm.
Did you? I don't know whether you ever
heard. No, I hadn't heard that one.
Yeah, me. You wouldn't let them go back out the front door. They had to go out the back door.
Now, there's some things, see, I can't complete, and I wouldn't tell you I know about them when mm-hmm. I don't know about them, you know. Mm-hmm. Things that I have witnessed and understood, and I've heard things from other people, yeah, I will repeat, but other things, you know, that you say that you're talking about now, I don't know anything about that. So, but I know the people that went on the three peace missions, and of those people that went on the peace missions, I think only around about five should remain in the class. Mm. Of course, you know, a few of them died, but some left, you know, for class. They don't come to class anymore. Trained them came here in 1971, and he said, Dr. Kinley told me that if you don't go to the convention in 1971, he said, you're going to die. That you have to go to the convention in 71. And Merck can tell you, I was going to go. But when he got up there and made that statement, I said, that's a lie. And I asked Dr. Kinley after that, did he say that? And he said, he never said that. He said, those who can afford to come to the convention, come. He said, if you don't have the money, and but won't you go too far in debt, you make the convention. But he did not tell Trainum to say, if you don't come to the convention, you're going to hell, you know, you're going to die. So that just was one of the things that when Trainum said that, I said, that can't be true. I know Dr. Kinley wouldn't make a statement like that. So I was, you know, I had already signed up to go and everything, but I didn't go. When he made that statement, that was just too much. I couldn't take that. You remember that, don't you, Marta?
She doesn't. She's in there.
When Dr. Trainum made the statement that Dr. Kennedy said, if you don't come to the convention in 1971, you're going to die?
Uh-huh, yeah.
And that's the reason why we didn't go to the convention. We went to Denver. And then we went on to, you know, Washington, and then
restaurant.
Straight back. Yeah, just turn on that black switch. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, didn't he say that the 1975 convention, which was an international convention, that's when afterwards he mm-hmm. wanted it broken up into regions, mm-hmm. something like that. Mm-hmm. Was there a particular reason why you wanted it done?
Because of the number of people that had shown up. We had a little over close to 1,500 people. And he said, I think it's time now to break it up into regions because of the fact that there'd be too many people, you know, the space wouldn't be big enough for you to hold your conventions. And so at the next convention, I think that they had, international convention was 87, they had a total of a little over 4,000 people. So, which was, he was right.
Yeah, which is what he didn't want to see, but they did it anyway.
Yeah, now they tell me in 2001, there was over 7,000.
Oh yeah, I was there, sir. Yeah. It was massive.
And they had to have two rooms.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember they even had a combined choir there, and it was like over 1,000 people just in a choir, you know. I mean, they had to put the stage up front, and it was, you know, going around the sides, and, uh-huh. you know, and uh-huh. it was massive,
massive.
To say the least.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, I know the Springfield Choir didn't participate in that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, could you tell us how the Springfield Choir came about and, you know, what led up to that?
Oh, my wife can tell you that. Well, we had what they call the Old Jerusalem Singers. Mm-hmm. And I was one of the members of the Old Jerusalem Singers, my wife was. And there was a fella by the name of Rocco that was one of the old Jerusalem's famous singers, and then also Nida Bell and Elizabeth Nicholson, and all there was Christine Kenley. Okay, those are the main ones that I know of. And anyway, when we would sing, my wife was baritone, and the person next to her, which was Rocco, he was a man. And he sang real high. He had a real high voice. And when they'd get to singing, people would look over and say, who's singing what? Because my wife was singing low, and this fellow, Rocco, was singing very high. But then, as we got some of the newer members in, we got some of the children of the parents to come in. Then they began to start their choir, and they called it the New Jerusalem Singers. Mm. And they really had, at the very start, they really could really, I mean, to tell you, man, how many they have in there? Didn't they have a total of a little over 50 people?
Yeah.
In the choir, and you, I don't know whether you went
to the... It might be more than that.
Might be more than that. I don't know whether you went to the 73 convention at Denver.
No.
You didn't go to that? Okay. Anyway, there was over, we got a picture of it somewhere around here. The choir there looked like they had, you're right, there were about 75 or other people that was in the choir. And this school had really grown up until all this stuff broke out, you know, here in Springfield. From Dr. Harris teaching, a lot of people went and started going to Columbus, some started going to Middletown, and then some would go to Dayton, and so our classes really kind of fallen off on account of that, because they think that Dr. Harris has the spiritual leadership of the school.
Well, it's said that Dr. Kennedy threw the mantle back to him.
Yeah, threw the mantle back to him, yeah. But the story behind it is this. Murray Gross told us the story that Dr. Kinley's first choice was Dr. Carl F. Gross. And Dr. Carl F. Gross told him that he was too old and he could not handle it as Dr. Kinley did. So then Dr. Kinley went back to the room, and Murray said he cried like a baby. And then after he wiped away his tears, he said, well, we'll make Dr. Harris dean then. Now, that's the story we got, as we know it to be, as Murray Gross told us.
How did Dr. Gross come to class? Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't know. I don't know, really. I don't know. But Dr. Carl F. Gross was our teacher. Because Dr. Kinley only came in through Springfield about maybe once a month. And but Dr. Gross would hold class once a week, and then we got to holding class twice a week, and then later on three times a week. But Dr. Carl Gross was our first teacher that I knew of. We had others that would get up and say things, like Brother Barbie and Brother Davis. And then Brother Bass said very little, but the main one was Carl Gross. And then my brother began to speak, and then Clifford Kennedy Jr. was speaking. So those are the speakers we had. And then when Dr. Kinley came back and we wanted him to stay here, then Dr. Kinley would, before he would speak, he'd say, anybody have anything to say? And there was about four or five of us, and I was one of them, always had something to say. And we'd get up on the floor, and we could talk until Dr. Kinley had to ring the bell on us, you know. And to make a long story short, after Dr. Kinley had charged Nathan and Gil and Richard and me, none of us could stay on the floor 5 minutes. We'd have to sit down. And then we'd get up again and maybe go another 5 minutes after everybody had returned. Because at that time, really what we knew and what we thought we knew was different. We thought we just knew everything, you know. Dr. Kinley, he was just patient with us, and he would go along with us, what, you know, what things were said.
Was Dr. Harris aware that he was the second choice?
Did he what?
Was he aware that he was the second choice?
I don't know. I don't know to this day whether he was aware of it or not. But I would think that he was, because Mary Gross sure told us back here in Springfield about it. And I know the word must have gotten back to him somehow.
I have a question. You said back in, you were first introduced into the class like in 44.
Mm-hmm.
You said you went to hear Clifford speak, and
mm-hmm.
he was talking on the body. Because
mm-hmm.
a lot of people, I think, are under the impression that Dr. Kinley didn't teach about the body until Dr. Harris came to the school.
Oh, yes, he did. And, you know, see, this is how Dr. Kinley wanted him to come to class and speak on the birth of a baby. And Dr. Harris, after he had spoken, Dr. Kinley got up and he got to the ramifications about the body and, you know, about the birth of a baby and so forth. And Dr. Harris was amazed at what Dr. Kinley knew, you know. And that these, well, why, Dr. Kinley knows as much as I do. He doesn't know the names, so-called names of the various parts of the body and the way, you know, they talk about the cells and what have you and all that. But Dr. Kinley, in the main, was speaking that way, yeah. Dr. Kinley had said, you know, I've been everywhere. I know everybody. And he said he didn't have to go on the peace missions because he'd been everywhere and he'd seen everybody and he knows everybody. So a man make a statement like that.
I was going to ask about the 75 convention. I was at that convention. That was my first convention. I was fairly young. I hadn't even been maybe 6-7 months in class. And I remember Dr. Kinley making the change. Like, we used to call it outer court, and then...
Answer the phone there, would you please?
It used to be called the outer court, and they changed the court roundabout. And on the dispensation chart, he moved the numbers over, the 6 and the 7, he moved them over. What was the reason why he did that?
Okay, now, I was the one that spoke up on some of these other changes about the dispensation. I know that they made the changes on the dispensational chart as to agree with what Dr. Kinley wanted. But
okay,
then I had asked Dr. Kinley, I said, now,
okay,
Dr. Kinley,
right,
we show
okay.
the outer court.
But right,
now,
right.
In the 40th chapter of Exodus, it says the court roundabout. Now, which is
right.
it? And Dr. Kinley said, you're right, it's the court roundabout. So he said, now change that. I want that change to show on your, you know, on your punch card, on your charts, court roundabout.
I don't know.
But I noticed still in the books that they've never changed it, have they? They
mm-hmm.
still show the outer court.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But he said that's the court. He said the outer court was where the Gentiles were.
Okay. I get it. Yeah, which is really not only outside the tabernacle, but it's also outside the camp of the Israelites.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, I get it now.
Mm-hmm. I wish I could tell you more. I mean, you know, things come to my mind after you leave. And
anything, because there's a lot of things we don't know. I mean, you know, I've been around long enough that I've heard stories from other folks, but, you know, but my knowledge is limited.
Yeah.
And this
well, I do know that this Dr. Farley, after I told you he was down here at this particular meeting, I do know that he was very ill prior to that time.
Mm-hmm.
And that Dr. Kinley and Dr. Harris had told the people, gather all the people, because he'll be dead tomorrow. And then Dr. Kinley went in and said, Farley lived. And Farley got better after that. And he told him to give the man some wine to drink. And
Dr. Harris said that he had come by and he had tea in the garbage pail, being a lot of wine bottles. He had been drinking wine, which was, I guess, was supposed to be good for the stomach. So, yeah. Dr. Farley, as a matter of fact, he was very active in the Masons, and we tried to warn him about, you know, he would miss class and not come to class because of Masons had a meeting, you know. So he wanted to go to those meetings rather than come to class. So then he kind of disobeyed, and a couple years after that he died. But he could have, and I know of several people in our class that were healed. Murdoch's cousin, we had taken him to class, you know, we told him if he'd come to class and learn. He had cancer, and he had cancer in the throat. And when we'd take him to class, we could hardly stand it in the car. It smelled so bad, you know, his breath and everything. And he went to class, and Yahweh cured him, or Dr. Kinley, you know, through the Spirit of Yahweh, cured him. So then he got better, and he's been a body man, working on, you know, cars. So he went back, rather than come to class, he went back on the body work on cars. And the cancer came back on him, and he died. Dr. Kinley told him, you don't fail to come to class, but if you do, you'll be sorry. These things have happened. And there's one other thing I'd like to tell you about. Now, this was through the Spirit of Yahweh, and I never told Dr. Kinley about this at all. But in 1963, I developed what was called nephrosis. Now, at the time that I got nephrosis, that was what it was. It was a disease of the kidneys. It's where the kidneys were not picking up, or my veins were not picking up the waste from my body, but it was picking up the albumin. And I was actually urinating albumin instead of the waste from my body, and I swelled up. From the waist down, I was in terrible shape. And when I come home from work one night, my wife had to cut my pants off because I couldn't get them off. They were so tight. And so I was placed in the hospital. They didn't know exactly at that time what was wrong. And they put a urologist on the case, and then my family doctor, he was on the case. And finally, they kind of left. So then I had gone back to work, and 6 weeks later it came back on me. And this time they put me into the hospital, and they found out that what I had was nephrosis. And they said it was a childhood disease, that if an adult got it, it was fatal, because they only know of three cases where a person lived 10 years afterwards. You know, that they did not come back on them, and they died. Well, they put me on some kind of, it was an antibiotic plus a prednisone, might have been that, the form of prednisone. And anyway, the waste went down. But I never had it. It never returned. I never had it since the year 1963. Now the doctor said you will get it again, and when you get it again, he said it could kill you. He said, but I guarantee you, he said it'll come back. And before the doctor retired in 1989, he was retiring in 90. He said he wanted to take me over to Ohio State University and show me off to those people that I had nephrosis and it was in the records and that I was still living. Mm. And I told him, I said, no, I don't have time for that. Mm. I said, I know who you took care of, my Yahweh. So mm. But that time I never asked Dr. Kinley to do something for me or anything. No. This just happened on my own, that I know that Yahweh took care of it. And just like my wife, now, this was the
when my wife was operated on for this cancer, you know, back in 69, and I was a heavy smoker, and I said, if Yahweh will heal my wife, this day I will quit smoking and I will not smoke anymore. And I never smoked a cigarette from that day. And that was some 34 years ago. So I know Yahweh is, he can do it. Murder?
Dad?
Come back.
Excuse me.
You Dad. Do you know anymore?
I was going to ask you if you could tell about your brother when he was went off to the military.
Oh, yeah. Now, let me tell you about mine first. Then I'll tell you about it. Yeah, see, I was in military service. And, after I was taking basic training, and all of a sudden I had a pain in my right side, and I didn't know what it was. Oh boy, it pained all night long. So they sent me to the hospital, and they operated on me, emergency operation, appendectomy. So anyway, somehow I got lost in the hospital. I was in the hospital for some 90 days, and I wasn't absent without leave. The guy that was in charge of our, what's called the 52nd Engineering Combat Regiment, I didn't get to go through basic, complete basic training, and he didn't know what had happened to me. I guess he felt maybe they'd sent me to some other hospital or what, but I was in this hospital for a little over 90 some days. And there was a lieutenant who had operated on me for, you know, an appendectomy. And he said, when they opened me up, he said, there was nothing wrong with my appendix. But since they had opened me up, they took the appendix out. And he said, you know one thing? He said, I don't think you like the military, do you? And I said, no. I said, I think I could do more on the home front. Well, he said, you know, he said, I'm going to take care of you almost since you get discharged. So I got a CDD, a Certified Disability Discharge.
Hmm.
And the people had been praying at home for me to return. Now, I was praying in the name of Lord God and Jesus Christ. I don't mean people in the class. Mm-hmm. I mean my grandmother and my aunt and uncle and all them said, going to church. Now, oh, Yahweh took care of that. But you know, that's why I say people really on the outside. Dr. Kennedy said, there's people on the outside that Yahweh's going to save.
Yeah.
They're not all here. He said, people of other faiths. So I believe, you know, even they, if they knew the truth, if they had an opportunity to get in on it, they would be there.
Could you elaborate?
I mean, they've never had the chance.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on how he explained that as far as, you know, other people's, you know, in other lands, you know.
Oh, okay. He said, their heart, they've got a pure heart. He said, and they want to know the truth. They know where they are isn't right, but they don't know where to go to be right, to get to right. So he said, but it's by their heart. Yahweh knows their heart. And said, that's how. He said, you know, he knows if they would get to the place, they would be there. And they would understand the truth. So Yahweh has a way of saving them in the last seconds of their life. He said they can get a panoramic view of everything just before they die. And he says Yahweh can take does that by giving them the understanding at that time. That's the way he explained it to us. Now, what were you going to say?
Oh, I was going to ask you to talk about your brother and how that he went off to the military.
Oh, yeah. Richard went to military, and he got there where he wouldn't shoulder a gun, you know. And he said he wouldn't shoot a rifle. He wasn't about to, you know, shoot anybody, so he didn't believe in shooting people.
And then before he left, Dr. Kinley said when he was ready to come back.
Yeah, I said, oh yeah, Dr. Kinley told him, said, now you go on into military service. And said, when you're ready to come home, he said, you'll be able to come home. He said, all you have to do is make up your mind, just go right on in. Said, but you'll come out when you want to. And so that's what happened. Richard told him he wasn't going to shoulder a gun after he was in there about 60 days. He was in basic training. And so they sent him over to the psycho ward. And when they sent him to the psycho ward, said, ain't nothing wrong with him. That he's normal. But Richard went back and he told what you call the company commander that he was not going to shoulder a rifle. So they gave him a discharge, an honorable discharge. So he came home when he wanted to come home.
Was his? I thought I remember him saying that his company was everyone in his company was killed over there.
No, that was my company.
That was yours?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, 95% of the people in my company that went overseas, 52nd Engineer. See, the engineers, they have to build the bridges and stuff like that for the infantry to go across. So they're in the front. And they're the ones that, you know, they don't have no much protection at all. Ain't nobody on the other side protecting them. So they're right in the line of fire. So there's 95% of the engineers, or the 52nd Engineering Combat Regiment was, done away with. Remember a guy came back here to Springfield and told me he was one of the few that got out, come out of that. But Richard, I don't think Richard knew whatever happened to his regiment. No. Well, these are some things, strange things that's happened in this class. I know it sounds absurd, but they are true, and they did happen.
Were you there when Joe Heisey went off? Right. You know, was
67 convention.
He comes
to our class.
I don't want that on the tape.
Actually, sometimes we'll put him on the floor and he's somewhat coherent sometimes.
I got to tell you something. I'm to blame for that.
Really?
I have to take the blame. What had happened, Larry and only he, who were to have taken care of Joe Heisen, they got to the place that they couldn't handle him anymore. So they said, Jack, will you please take him? So I thought, because, I said, if he preaches all night long, it's all right, I'll go to sleep, it won't make any difference. But anyway, Joe came here, and Joe said, they won't put me on the floor. They won't put me on the floor. And he kept on me day and night. I want on that floor, I want on that floor. So on Thursday afternoon, I told him, when he came here, and he said, look, I've got to get on that floor. I said, okay, Joe, I'll tell you what to do. I said, you go up and you sit on that stage. And I said, now, and then you'll be able to speak. They'll let you speak. So Dr. Kinley gets on the floor and he tells people, ignore him. Just ignore him back there. And every time he would mention the name of Joshua, when he is introducing Joshua to us, the name, because we in fact are called Lord God Jesus Christ. Joe would say, that's me. So finally Dr. Kinley got to the place he couldn't take it any longer. So he said, haul him out. So the four big guys grabbed him, one each leg, and arm, and they took him right on out. Yeah, but I was the one that was responsible for him being on the stage, and I'm sorry for that. Because he wanted to get on the floor. And I said, Joe, the way they'll recognize you, you go up there and you sit on that stage. They'll let you have something to say. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when a lot of doctrines come, like the stuff that they teach now, like all the angels sin, or Adam and Eve had sex in the garden, all this stuff was around during the time of Dr. Kinley, or like a lot of stuff that they teach now was around when Dr. Kinley?
No, that was not around. But the thing that was prevalent, so much prevalent then, was the fact that I'm Yahweh.
okay? And they wouldn't say that you're Yahweh too, but they'd say I'm Yahweh.
Oh, it was an exclusive type thing.
Exclusive, yeah.
Right, they'll put your names on themselves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And now, for example, if you notice the class down there in Florida, Glennie's class, Glennie Kinley's class,
Orlando.
Loopy now, all of them have taken the name of Kinley.
Mm. What?
All in Loopy's family have taken the name of Kinley. Even Loopy's new husband, Murda, even Loopy's husband has taken the name of Kinley, hasn't he?
That's right.
And the kids have taken the name of Kinley.
Wow.
Yes, he remarried and he took on the name of Kinley.
Wow.
Yeah.
So they come and visit here sometime?
Yeah. Glennie told them to come back here. Now, Ollie, who was here last week, Ollie Brett, she said Glennie told him to come back yearly,
mm-hmm.
but then Loopy said it was every other year, so they come every other year. Mm-hmm. And then with that other guy, there's a third one.
I don't know, there's three different groups that come up.
Three different groups, yeah.
And they've all split.
It's split, right.
In some sort of way. They don't all agree.
This is the old Pasadena class.
Yeah, the old Pasadena class. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they all come up in groups at certain times, and they come up and visit our school, but they also set up at the Springfield Inn normally and have their own classes as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, I'd like to ask you a question.
Okay.
Leonard Snellbaker.
Yes, sir.
Did he confess on his deathbed that he was preaching wrong?
Well, you know, I had heard that, and the person who told me that was Dr. Rip Macklin, Alfonso Macklin. I believe that's what he had said. He had told me that.
Uh-huh.
You know, but as far as the truth of the matter, I don't know, because the people that are left are still adhering to what he taught, and they're trying to keep. And well, after he died, Dennis Drulard more or less was there. Spiritual leader, so to speak, and they pretty much were still cohesive. But then after Dennis died, things kind of deteriorated with them. They still exist as a group.
Or do they?
They still exist. Matter of fact, our class, Ontario, visited them maybe like about several months before Dennis died.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we visited them, and in fact, I spoke on the floor, and then Dennis got. Matter of fact, I have the tape of that lecture. We could make it available, and we could send it to you if you like.
What about Bud Munch?
He's still there. He's still in Pomona class.
Pomona class.
Yes, he is. He's still there. As a matter of fact, it's interesting that you say that because you see, sadly to say, I have to admit I was part of that class at one time. You know. But then I left after I found out that it wasn't, you know, as it appeared.
Uh-huh.
10 years ago or so, several individuals defected from Pomona. You know, some of the higher ups that ran the class, and they came to L.A. class, became part of L.A. class. Told me personally that when if Leonard Snellbaker had told him to go whack somebody, he would have just said, okay, boss. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, this same individual, see, he and several others defected to L.A. class, and now this same individual is now in Los Angeles class, and he does the exact same thing. He's the bodyguard, he runs the security, and he handles classroom operations, the exact same thing in Los Angeles that he did in Pomona.
And did you know one thing that Dr. Harrison now beginning to say the same thing that Glennie said? And he told Glennie he was a liar. When Glennie said, I'm Yahweh, and Dr. Harrison said, so what? So now what he's up here saying, he's Yahshua, Yahweh Elohim. That's what they're saying now.
Mm-hmm.
You're no more, you said, you're a new person now, you're a new man.
and says, you got a new soul and all that stuff, and says, now you are Yahshua the Messiah.
Yeah, that was the thing that, like I said, when this came out several years ago, it was reminiscent for me, because I said, you know, this sounds very similar to some of the stuff I had heard.
Yeah.
And see, and you'd be, and I know the individuals, because I mean, I was there, and I know them who left, and they're now in Los Angeles, and some of them have very prominent positions in, you know, some like I said, Clarence Sale, another guy is Paul Dickey, does like a lot of the moderations and, you know, organizing things, and a couple of individuals that are in the choir, you know, that were there, that because they were doing, in other words, they were doing the same things in Pomona that they're doing now in Los Angeles.
Okay.
You know, at first when I saw that, I thought maybe it was like a, how can I say, just, what's the word, you know, like, you know, like when you win something, you know, like you dance in front of the field, you know, at the end zone.
Yeah.
It was like, okay, well, these guys came to my side, so now I'll put them in visibility, high visibility, to show that, hey, you know, they're my people now. Okay, but see, but now I'm beginning to look and begin to think that maybe it may be something more underneath the surface than what it appears to be.
Now, I'm going to ask you, is Shirley Akers still there?
I'm not familiar with her.
You know, but what about Vera Yates? Were you familiar with her?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir.
They were for some of the original ones that went out to California from here.
Where did Leonard start on? Did he start out over here?
He started in Los Angeles.
Started in Los Angeles. He come in, Clifford got in there. Clifford Henley Jr.
Didn't Glenn Kinley teach that we have immortal bodies now?
Yeah, he says there's no sin.
When did that come up? Was that before, when Dr. Kinley was still alive? Because his last lecture, he talks about if anybody that says that we have immortal bodies now.
No, the only thing I know that Glenn came out after Dr. Kinley died is the fact that there is no sin. There's no sin now. We're And I said, now, he said, there's no sin in this age. I said, now, I got with him on that. I said, now, what do you mean there's no sin in this age? Oh, I said, all those who know the truth. I said, well, no, you didn't say that. You said there's no sin in this age. There is sin in this age, but there's no sin in the kingdom. In the kingdom age, or there's no sin there. If you are in the kingdom, then there's no sin. Well, yeah, well, that's it, but... we're all supposed to be in the kingdom. I said, no, we're not. Not all of us. I said, Dr. Kennedy said, you got some of the biggest devils sitting up here in class. And you know, Dr. Kennedy told us, he said, and we had a lot of people here in Springfield at that time. And he said, I could go down the aisle and put my fingers or put my hands on the ones that are saved, and there wouldn't be many. And one time he had all of us teachers get together over at Nidabelle's house. And there were 16 teachers and two other people that weren't teachers. And he said, those who know the truth here in Springfield, I can count them on my two hands and have a couple fingers left over. And he says, and two, I want you to know this, they're not all teachers. So then here we were. I said, oh, Yahweh, let me be one.
One of the eight, please.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. That's interesting because that was eight people.
But on the other doctrine side, they use that. Do you know that? They refer to that statement to show that they're right. That Springfield doesn't know anything.
Yeah, well,
I used to be in the day
class. But Springfield could have been one of the eight.
Well, no, that we had a lot in there, and so there was only eight.
There were 16 teachers
on his fingers, you know. And so then, when we have various ministers coming from these various schools, and also I was in the Dayton class for a while, which is, they teach the other doctrine, and we had to combat it all the time. It was only like three or four of us that really believed the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things they would use. It's like, well, Dr. Kinley would come back year after year to teach the Springfield people because they didn't know anything, you know.
Oh.
And they would say, and then they used the reference about
what he just mentioned about the eight people he could count on his hand.
Yeah, but that was not at a general meeting. That was at a meeting in the basement of Doc Nidabelle's home, where he had called all the teachers together. He wanted to get them straight on a couple things. And that's where he made the statement about eight. He could count them on his two hands.
But I'm just saying that's what the other people say. You know, when you talk to them and they'll combat you with things, that's what they'll throw up in your face.
They take things out of context.
Yeah. And then also, one of the reasons that Dr. Gill does not want to have anyone say anything that Dr. Kinley said, well, I put my spirit in you or something. Is that how he phrased it? Maybe I wasn't
exactly.
I have
put my spirit in you.
But because I know you're aware of this, that they said that Dr. Kinley said that Dr. Harris had the Holy Spirit. So Dr. Gill does not want to be like he put himself against Dr. Harris. Because it's really not a man against a man. It's
right.
Really a satanic spirit versus Yahweh, you know,
mm-hmm.
or the spirit of Yahweh. So he doesn't want to show, you know, want that said. But when they use it, they have used that, you know, we hear that all the time, don't we, Dad? When they,
mm-hmm.
they'll say, in fact, we heard about a month ago, we had a question answered, because he's coming here, Dr. Harris, in August, late August. And one of the ladies that believed the way Dr. Harris believes, she says, well, I'm confused. Well, why would Dr. Kinley set up a satanic spirit over, or a demon over the class? Said, haven't you heard that, isn't it true that Dr. Kinley said that Dr. Harris have the Holy Spirit? You know, so...
Of course, I've never heard that.
But
I've
see, it's
never,
not
I've
in the transcript.
Dr. Kinley make that
yeah,
statement.
It's not on the tape. So it's got to be someone that, you know, just like we're sitting around, you know,
mm-hmm.
and he mentioned that. Because it's definitely not in the... there's one thing that I have, when I've read transcripts, he did say, I heard he did say it in one transcript. He said, no, Dr. Harris knows. He did say that. I read that. I don't know what transcript that was. But
you know, I want to say this. When I mentioned earlier that when you and your brother, Dr. Gill and Dr. Higgins were up in Columbus, and he said that you guys were going to be the teachers, I heard it said that he made a statement that people can listen to you all or go to hell. Did he say that?
Yeah, he said, because you know enough to save the world.
Yeah. Now, so you can use that in the same context.
Mm-hmm.
That would, to me, would be a saying that, yes, these men do have the Holy Spirit. But I've also know that people say Mixon did, Glenn Kinley, and you have all these groups sprouting up that have these men up on pedestals. You have
yeah.
the people that say, well, Mixon had the vision. He was up there writing the vision with Dr. Kinley. Say the same thing about Glenn. Say he had the vision. You know, and it just goes on through the school. But to me, where the vision is, and I can say this from experience, I've heard Dr. Gill, I mean, I've been raised under these teachers, Dr. Gill, Dr. Carr, Richard Carr, and the other ministers in Springfield, Nathan Higgins and others. They don't preach themselves. They don't preach Dr. Kinley as a man. They don't preach Oliver Gill or Dr. Harris or any man, but they teach you, just like I can read in the transcripts that Dr. Kinley said, to make me prove it to your satisfaction, and that you have to know it for yourself, and don't even put Dr. Kinley up on a pedestal. So, and to me,
right.
that's the difference.
That's right. That's what Dr. Kinley said. He said, look, I'm just a man like you. He said, the only difference between me and you is the fact that Yahweh gave me this divine vision and revelation. And if you understand it, then you're on a level close to where I am. And he said, that's what my job is to do, is to come down to your level, to bring you up where I am on the ladder. So that's what you all have to do. And when you stay up, he said, if you stay up above the sun, moon, and stars, what they're doing, instead of taking the natural to understand the spiritual, they're taking the spiritual to understand the natural.
They say that.
They're turned right around just the opposite.
The visitors we just had say that. They
yeah.
say you cannot understand the physical without the spiritual. That is exactly opposite of what Dr.
Yeah.
told us.
Right.
But they'll stand on it.
Right.
Well, you know, there was a statement made in the Columbus class, not to just be doing some, you know, chit-chat and hearsay, but I heard it with my own ears that one of the, you know, the dean over there said that someone asked about marijuana. And he said, oh, yeah, marijuana's up in heaven because it wouldn't be down here. Exactly. It wouldn't be down here, so it's got to be up there. You see what I'm saying?
This is the dean that said that?
The Columbus class. Columbus, Ohio
class. Just topsy-turvy here.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
Would they have to rationalize?
They smoking up there, ain't saying.
right along with Bob Marley, right?
Well, hey.
Now everybody can go wash their hands and turn off.
I'm sorry, sir?
She wants you to eat, so you'll go wash.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
first,
yeah.
Oh, my
You didn't want to argue with her.
I don't think so. Not that the tone of voice is not to be argued with.
Yeah, see, Stevie's got a girlfriend who's Chinese.
Yeah, I seen her last night.
And so that's why we went to King's Buffet.
They have
breakfast
food. Well, it was awesome for her.
Oh, yeah. Is that one of those eat all you want places?
It's awesome for her.
Eat all you want places?
Yeah, eat all you want places.
A lot of variety.
Well, Dr. Carr, I'm about right out of tape, I guess. But Dr. Carr, I really appreciate everything that you said, and what we're going to do. We're just going to share it with our class, and you know, and
I hope that I've said something that will benefit someone.
You know, I've learned an awful lot just sitting here listening to you, and it's been a real pleasure. And thank you very much. And on behalf of our Ontario class, thank you very much, because we're located 40 miles east of Los Angeles, and we're really the only class in the Los Angeles metro area that's still keeping on with what Dr. Kinley taught, despite the fact that we're surrounded by warring nations and such. But we're a small class, but we're very vocal.
And you continue in the faith.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Man, the tape just ended, don't that? Just ended.
Okay, go ahead. You
want to
go?
Oh, yes, sir.